G'day. Now we're going into video number 3 of the How to Build an Expansion Chamber, How to Design One series. And so far in video 1 we've got our exhaust timing, showing you how to do that. And from the next one we've used a formula from swept volume. I had to do a re-upload of that one to get that equation right. And the rated kilowatts to get our break mean effective pressure. That is the pressure. It's average cylinder pressure, and from that guide we can extrapolate average temperature using Blair's guide, which is 5 bar BMEP would represent around 350 degrees Celsius, up to 11 bar around 600 degrees Celsius. So if I went 21 kilowatts, will update that, about 10.75 to bring it up to 600. That done, the next part of it is to move on to calculating the tuned length with that in mind, which what we're going to do here. And there's two main components to that. One is calculating how long the exhaust port is open for in time, knowing the RPM, and the speed or sonic velocity inside the pipe, or speed of sound inside the pipe, based upon the temperature, average temperature, in addition to some gas values that determine the density or properties of the gas, which to some degree has an effect. Once we make those figures, we can then calculate some final figures for the actual tuned length, which is the distance from P up to D6 in the expansion chamber. That then goes on to calculate all of these dimensions, these L dimensions, which are all based upon the tuned length. Okay. Later video we'll cover the next part of it, which is the D values here, and they're all derived from port area. We'll get into that, but at this stage we'll cover the tuned length calculation. So I'll show you that equation next. To the equation. As I said, we have to begin with our velocity or speed of sound. So calculating the speed of sound is largely based on the average exhaust gas temperature and to some degree the makeup of the gas inside the expansion chamber. Now, Blair provides some helpful numbers in that relationship called a specific heats ratio and a gas constant. Now these are the figures given for air, but exhaust differs slightly. Now the guide that Professor Blair gives for these varies a little bit with temperature, but mostly with air-fuel mixtures. So the values I've taken here are for air-fuel mixtures of 13 to 1, which is in the ballpark of a petrol-powered two-stroke underpower. Now, we take those values, knowing what the gas is itself, and then we take the actual total average temperature of the pipe I showed previously. So that's the temperature in Celsius. And we can easily convert that to kelvins by adding 273.15, or we could just use the Windows calculator or any calculator with a converter to convert Celsius into kelvins. So we use a variable Y for our specific heats ratio value. We use a variable R for our gas constant of 300. As I say, that changes with air fuel ratio. Blair gives a value from 13 to 1 up to 15 to 17 to 1. So I'm using the 13 to 1. We take those two values with our temperature in Kelvin and we bring it down here to this first formula to get the velocity or speed of sound at those conditions, in those conditions, meters per second. So we take our Y, 1.36 times R, 300 times temperature in kelvins. If it was 600C, then we add plus 273 to that. So that would be 873.15. So multiply Y times R times temp in K, write that figure down. The next thing we have to do is to get the square root of that figure. If you know how to do that, fine. If you don't, I'm going to show you in the Windows calculator, standard calculator. Click on the tick button, take this value you've written down, paste that into your calculator, and hit equals. And that will give you the square root of that value. And that will be the velocity in meters per second of the wave moving through the pipe, or the localized speed of sound inside the pipe. After that, the next thing we need to know, as I mentioned briefly in the previous screen, software screen, was the exhaust port time in milliseconds. And to get that, we take the amount of degrees that the exhaust port is open for, whether that's 170, 180, 190, or 200 degrees, whichever it is. Take that value, divide it by 360 degrees, because there's 360 degrees in a circle. Write that figure down. We want RPM, because we're in milliseconds. We want to convert revolutions per minute to revolutions per millisecond. So we take 60,000 divided by our RPM. Write that figure down. So take our first figure that we've written down, multiply it by our second figure, and we get exhaust port time in milliseconds at that RPM, how long the exhaust port's open for. So now we know the speed of the wave, and now we know how long it's got to go all the way up to the end of the pipe and back in time before the exhaust port closes. So now we can take the actual tune length in millimetres. First of all, we take our velocity here. Notice that is in meters per second. So we want to normalize that with our output, which is in millimeters. So we times 1,000. So take your velocity in meters per second times 1,000 and write that figure down. The next is our exhaust port time in milliseconds. Now that's in milliseconds, so we want to actually use a value of seconds. So we take our exhaust port time, divide it by 1,000, and write that down. Take our first number, multiply it by our second number, and that gives us twice the tuned length, which is the amount of distance the wave has to travel when the exhaust port opens, all the way up the pipe to the end of the baffle cone where the beginning of the stinger is, and back. So for pipe dimensions, obviously it has to be half that, because it has to go up and back, whereas the pipe only has to be that length, that one length. So we take this one that we've calculated, these two multiplied by each other, the figure we've written down there, and we divide that by two. And that will give us the tuned length in millimetres. So now we've covered that part, we are going to be able to dimension our pipe as far as the L, or the lengths, because each of these figures is a ratio that's in relationship to that tuned length value. So tuned length being from the port window, right where the piston is in the cylinder end, all the way out to the end of the baffle cone where the stinger meets. The other dimensions, now we've got this, we can work those out, but not quite yet. The other dimensions are the diameters. Now the diameters are not linked to the actual tuned length of the pipe. The diameters take into account the amount of pressure we've got in the cylinder, and the swept and the volume that's in that pressure, which tells us our total mass of air that's in there under pressure. So we've got to figure out how much back pressure we want in the pipe. So we know the pressure, but we've got to find out what size the hole is that it comes out of the exhaust port, and we've got to know that in the exhaust port area. And once we know the exhaust port area, and I'll show you that in the next video, and show you how to measure that quickly and simply with the exhaust off. And I'll cover that in a little bit of detail, but we're not going to the degrees of doing specific port time analysis. So we don't need to take 1 millimeter slices over time of the exhaust port as we would have to, and we can do some fairly basic measurements there that don't require disassembly of the engine and can be measured with the pipe off. And I'll show you how to do that. And once we have the port area, these D1 values are all values and ratios in relationship to the area of P, the port. Also taking into effect these port to pipe ratio, port to mid size ratio, and port to outlet size ratio. But as I explained before, we've got a certain amount of volume in the cylinder at a certain amount of pressure. So that's why these figures here have to have some bearing on the actual pressure that we're releasing and mass we're releasing, the volume at a certain pressure we're going to release, and how much builds up into here, and how much subsequent back pressure we get. So the total volume of the pipe is not merely linked to the swept volume, because in a swept volume with atmospheric pressure, far less pressure is going to come out into here. Whereas if we put a whole lot of pressure into the same amount of volume and then let it out, then it's going to be more pressure in here, and the back pressure is going to be greater. So the back pressure is the issue we have to get right, because under the correct back pressure, we're not going to have sufficient port plugging at our peak. And too much back pressure, we're going to experience a bit of overheating piston. So that will be in the next video. If you've got any questions, please hit the comments section. If you like the video, hit the like. If you subscribe, I'd appreciate that too. And I'll see you in the next video. Bye for now.